And hello, and welcome back to Harmonia. Last time, we started the game. We're a robot, met a girl, came into town, and decided to go to the library because we want to fix a music box, which I totally, completely support. And we headed to said library, on the outskirts of the town. There are no people passing by, even within the city. It was a lonely place. There are many cracks as well as ivy crawling up the walls of the facility. She said, smiling sadly. So, that blue girl is inside here. In what way do you mean blue? I could think of many different kinds of blue, but I would not understand until I met her in person. Whatever the case, my heart was set on fixing that music box. So Shiona and I stepped towards the old library. Once inside, it seemed like it hadn't been touched for years. Well, hopefully we didn't get any groceries that need to be, like, refrigerated or anything. And then again, I'm not sure anyone has a refrigerator, if electricity is so hard to come by. Also, upon entering, a lukewarm, stagnant air surrounded us. It made it difficult to breathe. Every time I tried to catch my breath, dust stuck to the back of my throat. However, moving past the entrance, I was taken aback by the sheer volume of stored books. The bookshelves almost reached the ceiling of the stairwell, and were packed to the brim with books. Every volume was thick and old, and each had characters written on the cover that were difficult to read. Amazing. So, these are books, huh? It was best described as a wall of paper. The scent of dried plants filled the air. How can I find the book I'm looking for in all this? We should look for her. Why do you say that? She lives here. I wonder if the blue girl could really find our book within this massive stock. It was hard to believe, but if Shiona was saying it, then it had to be true. But how do we go about looking for her? This place is huge. Shiona pointed towards the back of the library, with a thin, pale figure. Finger. Over there. Alright, let's go. Let us go. After walking a bit, Shiona slowly began to shake her head. I'm guessing you don't want to deal with her then. Shiona rested in a nearby chair. Maybe not necessarily out of not liking that, but probably just not being wanting to be confronted with that style of emotion. Even though I was carrying half the weight, Shiona had still walked quite a while with the groceries. Yeah, okay, I suppose that's reasonable too. She also followed me when I selfishly suggested going here. Judging by her facial expression, Shiona looked really tired. Alright, Shiona, I will be right back. Leaving Shiona behind, I went forth into the back of the library. I advanced towards where the blue girl was. The library was fully carpeted, and enveloped in silence, even footsteps did not penetrate. There were windows, but no direct sunlight got in, leaving it quite dark. In the dimly lit building, I quickly made my way forward. Just how many bookshelves had I watched go by? After what felt like ages, I finally arrived. I stood in front of the blue girl Shiona had mentioned. Huh? Really? Huh. You look like you're just a little girl. And you're the librarian here. Teddy bear and all. The blue girl was waiting quietly in the innermost area of the library. She sat on the carpet, her tiny legs sprawled out in front of a bookshelf, so enormous it almost reached the ceiling. She had long hair that reached her waist. It soaked up the light, glowing with a bluish color. She held a teddy bear in her arms, clutching it to her chest. Her small shoulders shook, and I could make out tears pouring down her cheeks in thin rivulets. Well, I mean, why are you crying at the moment? The blue girl watched me, with tears streaming down her face. My name is Ray. What is your name? Well, that makes for the three voice characters, so I guess we've met them all at this point. I see. TP, may I ask you something? TP, why are you crying? She must have watched a key anime. Tippy continued to cry. Endless tears for no reason. I couldn't understand it. I knew that humans cried. When they were sad or happy, whenever their emotions got too heavy, they began to cry. But this blue girl, Tippy herself, did not know why she was crying. Tears being cried for no reason puzzled me. I couldn't stop the tears of the young girl right in front of me. For some reason, this left me with a slight pain in my chest. Tibby looked up at me while clutching her teddy bear tightly. I came to search for a book. It's hard to explain. A book on music boxes. There is a broken one that I want to fix, but I do not know what they are made of. Yeah, do you know of any? Aren't you knowledgeable yourself? Yes, this will be very helpful, thank you. The shape is, square, with a handle attached. I guess that most music boxes were shaped like that. Tippy tilted her head, puzzled. It has Shiona's brother's music in it. Ah, but you would not know that. You got that?
ついてきて.
Okay. Well, thank you. Tippy slowly got up, wiped away her tears with her sleeve, and daintily started walking. That would imply that she is at least aware of the music box. Interesting. I guess that since she lived in the same town, it wasn't strange for her to have known about Shiona's music box, right? Right? Probably? Maybe? Not possibly. It even seemed like Shiona knew about Tippy. Just as she asked, I followed behind her. Without missing a beat, Tippy directed me to a bookshelf in the corner of the library. And suddenly she turned around and said, oh, you don't have like a ladder? Wait, what? She said with a tearful face. Alright, like this? I put my hands under her arms and lifted. She was remarkably light, leaving a distinct impression of being very young. Another case of someone that seems like they've, based on the descriptions that people have given and whatnot, makes it seem very unlikely that they are really the age they appear. Which means, again, that it seems more likely that, you know, thyroid. How is this? I followed her detailed instructions faithfully. After a moment, I could feel Tippy's body getting slightly heavier. Looking up, I noticed she held a thick book in her tiny hands. Reaching the floor, Tippy passed me the book and began dusting off her skirt. A thin cloud of dust surrounded us. Really? This is the book? I had my doubts. Without even looking it up, Tippy went to the bookshelf straight away. Out of this unbelievable amount of books, could she possibly have known all the books there? This little girl. While my doubts remained, I opened the book. In it were pictures of music boxes shaped like the one that was at Shiona's home. Turning the pages, sections on the internal construction, diagrams and detailed explanations of all the parts and build order were listed. But the strange thing was, the characters in this book were not printed, they were handwritten. The characters and diagrams were all hand-drawn on pure white pages. That's convenient. I wonder who wrote it. Wouldn't be her, maybe. Or the brother, maybe. But this was unmistakably the book I was looking for. Thanks. This is the book. Is it okay if I borrow it? Is that a yes or no? Tippy looked at me with her tear-filled eyes and walked away without saying anything. As she walked, her long hair swayed slightly. I could not just turn my back on this little girl, so I followed behind her. Tippy returned to her original spot and resumed crying. I could see why she'd seem very bloom. There was no end to these tears. My chest felt tight just looking at her. Tippy, what's the matter? Is something wrong? Am I not allowed to borrow books? Tippy was just crying for the sake of crying. I had achieved my goal, but I could not bring myself just to leave her. I mean, it's not unheard of that people cry as a way of venting, essentially. Even little things might be enough to get you there. Little things you may not be aware of. The state of things, even. Person to person, but it is, yeah. Don't really want to leave someone just like crying profusely. I sat down a short distance away from Tippy, beside her. Perhaps she was surprised. Tippy opened her eyes wide and stared at me. I cannot leave you by yourself like this. Tippy took a couple moments to think. And slowly, she moved towards me, still crying. I couldn't do anything for this young, crying girl. All I could do was put my hand on her head, as it rocked gently. My left hand could feel that her body temperature was a bit high. So there is a reason. Tippy said with a shaky voice. I couldn't read her expression. All her face was pointed at the ground. I see. So you're waiting for your mother and father to come back. Where did they go?
わからないの。
Saying that, Tiffy began silently sobbing to herself again. All I could do was sit there, next to her. How much time had passed by? How much time had I made Shiona wait? I felt like the light coming in from the windows had dimmed a little. Saying, Tiffy. Leaving you by yourself really hurts. But I do have someone waiting for me. I should probably get going. Tiffy raised her head and wiped her reddened eyes on her sleeve.
May, mata koko ni kite kureru?
Of course. I will come back to see you again.
Settai. Settai ni da yo.
Promises are always so easy to keep. Yes, I promise. Do not worry. I was not just saying it either. It was what I felt as I looked at those little tears. Yes, I promise. After promising multiple times, I left Tiffy where she was. So, my first... Yeah, you'd probably guess how long that took. Especially with how long it took. Well, my first guess would be something along the lines of... Let's say she was a little girl bought as a thyroid to replace a possibly dead child in a family and was left here at some point around the point when everything happened. And she was told to stay here, possibly. Like, stay here, we'll be right back for you. That would be my first guess. And the parents had no choice. But not be able to not be able to come back because they likely, whatever it was, died. That would be my first guess. Shiona was waiting by the entrance. She asked me a question as though to make sure it was me. I think I understand what you were getting at.
Sokka. Kaerou ka, Rei.
Yeah. We turned our backs to the library and left only Tiffy. The blue girl. Behind. I will say, if you haven't noticed, I have sort of intentionally been doing it, where I try to take at least the voice lines of Rei here, and I try to make them feel a little bit more formal, and just, like, when I say them out loud. Like, I go from won't to will not, that sort of thing. Because you sound a bit more formal that way. And I'm purposely doing that, actually. Because he feels like he's in a state where he's not great with emotions, and that sort of state feels like it would be emphasized a bit better by being very formal in your speech. Being very, you know, matter-of-fact, and, you know, talking properly, not using shortcuts in English and that sort of stuff. If you haven't noticed, yeah, I am purposely doing that. I'm not perfect about it, but I am doing this all on the fly, too. So. And that might be me just, like, projecting some, like, opinion I have about him onto him, so. Eh. Okay, sorry, back. After arriving home, I immediately headed to the living room. The broken music box was there. I opened the book I took from the library and began to study the structure of said music box. Just as I thought, one of the gears was broken. That's why it didn't matter how much I turned the lever. The disc wouldn't turn, and thus no sound would come out. But what was I to do about that gear? Yeah. It takes a lot of precision to make a small gear. But what was I to do about that gear? Could I make one? By following the dimensions listed in this book? No, I couldn't. Without any answers, I kept turning the pages. In the back was a list of products shown by their manufacturers, as well as a list of the parts used. When I skimmed it, my eyes fixed on a certain spot. And what I gathered, the manufacturer of the music box also made Colossus. There was a manufacturer, and we have a detailed manual on it that's handwritten. That's a bit odd. Oh, also made, I wonder if it's the same one? Which meant that they might have used some of the same precision parts in the clock. Unexpectedly, I remembered when I had broken Matt's clock in his shop. I wonder if it's the same manufacturer. Hey, you know that thing I broke? Can I have some of its parts? Now that clock, maybe if he has no use for it, and he's just going to throw it away, then. If I was able to use the gears inside the clock, maybe I could fix this music box. Just as I was figuring out how to fix it, Shiona entered the living room. Shiona, listen. I might be able to fix this music box using the gears from the clock in Matt's shop. Shiona's smile looked happier than ever. Okay, it's a big might. No guarantee it's the same manufacturer, no guarantee it uses the same parts, no guarantee of a lot of things. So, you know. I could see her happiness from her expression. Taking the music box into her hands, Shiona began to sing. It was the same song she sang in the chapel. That strangely nostalgic song. That song that made me feel a warm glow in my chest. While Shiona gazed lovingly at the music box, I felt my resolve to fix it strengthen. I wanted to fix the music box for her. And I wanted her to be happy. These thoughts made my chest feel like it might burst. Tomorrow, I will go to Matt's shop again. Maybe I could persuade him to give me his clock somehow. But there was one thing I was worried about. I was the one that broke the clock in the first place. I'd apologize, but that did not mean that going there would be easy. And just thinking about Mad getting angry left me terrified. Shiona's words reached me as I wavered.
オレンジ色にできるの。そうなってほしいって願われて作られた歌だから。それがお兄ちゃんの願いだから。だから私ね、この歌を多くの人に聞いてほしい。そして多くの人を笑顔にしたい。それが私の願いなの。
Shiona carried on, as though she were talking to herself. But her words pushed me towards my goal. I was going to Matt's shop once again the next day. And I was going to apologize for breaking his clock once again. Shiona's voice and the music box reinforced my resolve. And the next day, I went to Matt's shop alone. Oh, this will be fun. Maybe I could work my way to paying it off and, you know, owning it myself, sort of. I thought of turning back countless times along the way. We could certainly bargain with him. But what kept me going was Shiona's smile. I wanted to look at that smile all day. And that's why I wanted to fix that music box for her. I thought about how determined I was the day before, and about what I could do for Shiona. I made up my mind and stepped into Mad's shop. Immediately after, Mad's words rolled over me like a distant thunder. I wanted to run away, but I did not. I wanted to apologize more properly for what I did yesterday. I had Shiona with me. I wanted to try to do it by myself, properly. I'm sorry. But I cannot do that. I'm really sorry for breaking your clock yesterday.
いくら謝っても時計は壊れたままだ。帰れ。
I'm sorry. I am really, really sorry. I kept apologizing while keeping my head down. How much time went by like that? Finally, Mad spoke with a slightly softened tone. Yeah, if you insist on apologizing, eventually they're gonna, at minimum, accept it as sincere. I did what he said. There stood Mad, with what seemed to be a look of surprise on his face. I am sorry.
Oh, I am Arna.
Although he said that, it seemed to lack the anger from yesterday. Though I noticed the sound of a small sigh coming from him. Actually, I have one favor to ask.
Tanomida.
Yeah, that's the thing, isn't it? My feet were frozen with fright, but Chiyoma's words pushed me forward. That clock. Will you give it to me? That clock, will you give... I froze, standing in attention like I had just been struck by lightning. It was pointless. I could work for it. Put me to work. I'll pay it off like what you'd get for it otherwise, and I'll take the broken parts of my own. I had to give up. Oh, come on. Just as I was about to run away, a voice came from behind me. Of course she followed me. I thought she was at home, but there stood Chiyoma. Chiyoma stepped between me and Mad fearlessly. She kept smiling as she explained to Mad. A noble effort with needs for a noble cause. Oh, you can't say no, you can ya? Can ya? Mad's expression slowly softened, and the bright red hue drained from his face. What, you didn't keep it and try to fix it yourself? Oh well. Mad turned away from us, but continued to speak. Okay. Well, that's certainly an option then. Saying this, Mad sat down facing the wall. Still smiling, Chiyoma gave Mad a slight bow and left the shop. Thank you very much. I made the same slight bow and left the shop. That is interesting. She informed me as we left the shop. That is the place where you throw away trash, right? So it's likely buried at this point. Does Matt take items he finds there, fix them, and then sell them in his shop? It made sense. So, that was why he had so much old stuff in his shop. He took things that were so usable, and then proceeded to reuse them. Whatever the case, I decide to head off towards that abandoned factory. Chiyoma, if it is okay, could you guide me to where the garbage dump is? The red children? Are they angry? She probably met the children that had talked to her the day before. when I thought about then. She also promised to treat them to Sue.
Demo, Rei, hitori ja ikenai yo ne. Kodomo tachi to no yakusoku, kodowatte kuru ne.
Oh, no, 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 no. You promised those children, come on. I'm not in such a hurry. At the very least, I could go by myself, come on. No, do not worry about it, Chiyona. Please, keep your promise to them. I will go to the library. I want to look over a map and learn about the area. Shiona's expression seemed to cloud slightly. What is wrong, Shiona? Good question. I would not say that she hates me. Why? That seemed like an odd thing to be concerned about, but okay. Yeah, I'll check it out. See you later. Turning around, I headed towards the library. At that time, her smile seemed a bit off, like it was fraught with sorrow. But I did not know why. Perhaps she knows TP's true situation and... Perhaps she knows TP's true situation and is of the opinion that she can't do shit about it, and knows that I will be made sad myself by becoming aware of it, that sort of thing, because I probably can't do shit about it either, something like that. Tippy was in the same spot, still crying the same way. Yeah, I'm here. Tippy, hey, can I ask you something? Do you have any maps of the town in this library?
あるよ. たくさんある.
Great. Can you show me where they are?
いいけど.
Tippy could not get the words out. What is wrong? Are you not feeling well?
そうじゃないけど.
Tippy blushed slightly. She still looked sad, but her cheeks were a bit rosier. Oh dear. No, do you mean like last time? No, it's fine. Come over here. Well, if we wanted to be efficient, we could get the map and I could look it over here while I was doing that. I extended my arms and she got up, and then hesitantly jumped up to my chest. I was holding her, although differently than last time. But I thought the same things. Holding her, I noticed how small and soft and fragile she was. Is this okay to be? Tippy began rubbing her cheek against my chest. I could feel my chest grow warm, as she did. Was this emotion the feeling of fondness? I wanted to protect this girl. I wanted to stop her tears. I stayed there and held Tippy for a moment. Tippy pointed the way to go while she snuggled against my chest. I followed her directions, while I continued to hold her. Apparently, there is an abandoned factory near the town, and that is where I want to go. I am looking for a part, and it might be there. Yeah, that's right. I want to fix Shiona Brothers' music box, no matter what. As I carried her, Tippy led me directly to the shelf that held the map of books, or book of maps. Did he really memorize where every book is? That is amazing. Did someone teach you? After saying the words, Mommy and Daddy, Tibby's eyes began to well up. I took out a book of maps just to change the subject. Sitting down there, I opened the book. This one also had hand-drawn maps, just like the book about music boxes. Were all the books in this library handwritten? Their number was phenomenal, if that were so. Just who in the world had written so many books by hand? I almost felt faint on contemplating the endless stretch of time required for such work. This is pretty beaten up. How old is this book? Interesting. So, it might be inaccurate now. I thought it was a map from decades ago, at least. But the buildings seem to be in the same locations as in the town right now. Well, that really is more saying about how much the town has changed physically. There are some pages that were badly discolored, as though tea had been spilled on them. Some weren't even stuck together. I suspected they'd rip off if I pulled on them. I wonder, maybe they're handwritten in because, not because someone wrote them, but maybe someone who had read a bunch of them had come in basically like, oh, this is starting to fade away, I'll just write it in again. That sort of thing. So we can, you know, re-up it, basically. Refresh it. I flipped through the pages carefully. Oh, I think this may be it. I found the symbol for the factory located in the north of the town. Judging by the distance from Giona's house as well, it was very likely that this was the place. I wonder. Shiana seems nice enough that it would be almost odd if she had not been a similar situation with her at some point or another, but then just couldn't stand it anymore and, you know, stopped wanting to go near her, basically. Hence why she acted like she did yesterday. I patted her tiny back countless times. Don't worry, I'll be back again. Of course. I promise. What a saying when you think about it. Yeah. I crossed my heart and hoped to die. I kept promising over and over to Tippy. Why did I do that? Regardless, I felt wrong when I left. A feeling bubbled up inside me and urged me to stay there with Tippy forever. I pushed down the feeling and made my way out of the library. As I entered the ruined factory that the map led me to, I could smell oxidized oil. I could certainly imagine. Apparently, this factory used to produce the arms and legs for fibroids. There were unfinished fibroid arms and legs scattered all around me. None of them had artificial skin applied to them yet, so the machinery was clearly visible. Looking closely, I could see that they were built the same as my own right hand. I knew they were just inanimate objects, but it was still a creepy sight. I tried to push away some of the scattered arms with my right hand. The sound of metal hitting metal echoed sadly through the factory. I decided I should come back here if any part of my body were to break. There were plenty of spare parts to be found here. There were several large drums full of oil in the back. Most were oxidized, but there were some unopened ones too. If I ever ran out of oil, I figured I could come here for maintenance where no one would see me. Well, maybe. I wonder what my oil situation is, and it does make me curious about the construction of the thyroids. The farther I walked into the factory, the more my worries seemed to fade away. This abandoned factory was sure to be an important place to me. But I couldn't find one thing that I was looking for. That was, of course, the clock that Mad supposedly left here. But there were no clocks in this factory, or anything that looked like trash at all. Perhaps the trash is thrown away outside rather than inside of the factory. I left the factory for a moment to look around outside. Just behind that factory, I found a whole area piled high with machine parts. There were a lot of trash strewn around among the machine parts as well. Ah, this must have been the town dump. There were probably more people than just Matt who came here to look for things they could use. I looked up at the mountain of trash, several times taller than myself. So, where could it be? There was a huge amount of trash. Conducting a systematic search would be a back-breaking jump. But there was nothing else I could do. I immediately got to work, starting with the pile at my feet, and immediately regretted not asking him where the fuck he throws away his trash typically. I do not know how long it took. It had been a long while since I had felt any sense of time passing. My hands were filthy from having moved the dirty metal plates and oil-covered containers. My clothes were slick with oil, and large stains had appeared all over them. But even then, I continued to cross the carpet of trash, swim through the filthy rivers, and bathe under scrap metal waterfalls. Finally, I found it. The clock from Mad's shop. Why, that lucky. The one I broke yesterday, I suppose typically it would be unlikely if it had been covered up significantly. It would be at a very surface level at this point, in terms of the layers of each pile. I found it. I picked it up and watched its hands closely. Of course, they weren't moving. I put it to my ear, but it made no sound. This is only to be expected, since I had broken it. This clock would probably never tell time again. That realization felt like a small stab to the chest. Hey, Kilt! I clutched the clock gently to my body and started walking back the way I'd come. Okay, cool.
Okaerinasai.
Now, do we have the parts to take it apart and figure out exactly if it is what we need? Do we have... I suppose it doesn't take too much if we really just need to replace one part in the music box, but... She only greeted me kindly. I'm back. Here it is. I held out my oil-stained prize, and Shiona smiled pleasantly. Shiona gave me a towel and a change of clothes. I suppose she did have a brother, right? I wiped off the oil and changed, and then went to the living room. Shiona greeted me again there. Can you shower and stuff like that? Should you shower and stuff like that as a thyroid? I wonder. I suppose there probably isn't that much water to, use. No, I'm fine. I want to get right to work. I'm fine. For some reason, I just do not feel tired at all right now. Yeah, I know. I'll eat later, so you go ahead and eat now. Shiona left the living room. I watched her leave and then got to work. Okay. This is very detailed then. I opened up the book I borrowed from the library. This music box was made so that when someone turned the handle, gears different sizes turned against each other, spinning a disc at a set speed. Apparently, turning the handle faster wouldn't speed the song at all. Wouldn't speed up the song at all. Okay. That's... interesting. Huh. I was really impressed by that technology. I'm trying to think of how that would work. Gear ratios are a thing, but they're also ratios to other gears. So how would you standardize that so that the different turning speeds... Maybe you could do something along the lines of... You turn the gear, but you only turn it, like, part of the way, maybe? So perhaps you have a system in place where the gear turns, but it doesn't let you turn it anymore until it reaches another point. Something like that. Like the initial mechanism of interacting the handle with the gear system. So if it gets turned so much, but it doesn't have any other force applied to it until it reaches another point, at the very least, you could at minimum make a max speed it could go at. Maybe you could slow it down if you went too slow, but, you know. I'm not sure exactly how you do that, though. I'm not that familiar with that sort of system. It's been a while since I dealt with gear-based... specifically gear-based systems, basically. If you didn't know, mechanical engineer here, so... Though I don't do a whole lot of mechanical engineering in my line of work currently, so... A lot more... Electromechanical, you know, integration and that sort of stuff. I followed the book's assembly instructions backwards and took the music box apart. Then I compared which parts were visible. Partway through, I noticed the vice gear was broken. The drive gear, I bet. Due to its high precision, a simple break in just one tiny part caused it to stop working. I suddenly found myself looking at my right hand. First, I would need to search the clock for something the size of the correct gear. Well... Oh, is that the clock? Oh yeah, that does have a lot of gears in it. Okay, time to disassemble it. So if we have a little crack in it, then at the very least we have an example of the gear that we need. Also, the thing about gears is that they're pretty dependent on the number of teeth as well. The actual radius and diameter and whatnot are pretty important for the actual design of a gear system, but teeth are also pretty important in order to make sure that they actually work correctly within the gear system. Next, I started to take the clock apart. I took off the case and used a screwdriver to remove the screws. We have a screwdriver? I suppose we probably should. When I removed the case, I could see the machinery inside. Maybe that wasn't showing prior? Clockwork's pretty cool. I mean, all those sort of gears and whatnot. It was full of gears more precise than those in the music box. One of them, a rather large gear, had a broken axle, and that's what prevented it from working. That was probably where I'd broken it yesterday. Mad threw away the clock because there was no replacement gear the same size. Fortunately, the broken gear wasn't of the sizes I needed for the music box. Taking things apart made me feel awkward somehow. After all, I had to break the clock in order to fix the music box. Actually, isn't it really weird that he threw this away? If he's someone who takes stuff and fixes them up, wouldn't he have a supply of parts like replacement gears that he just keeps? It would probably be better for him to disassemble something and simply use it as a storage of extra parts and whatnot for, you know, stuff like what I'm doing right now. Maybe he was just too mad to be able to bring himself to actually go about doing it. I don't know. After all, I had to break the clock in order to fix the music... taking things apart made me feel awkward somehow. After all, I had to break the clock in order to fix the music box. Maybe I felt this way because I knew exactly what I was. Huh? Okay. I wonder if this will come back later. Where I have to fix, like, another fibroid by breaking myself or something like that. I hesitated a bit, but then took apart the clock as carefully as possible to show it some respect. I lined the clock's gears up on the table by size and compared them to the one from the music box. There it is. I had found a gear that was roughly the same size. Now all I had to do was follow the book's instructions and transplant it into the music box. Okay. I think this should do it. Now the disc should spin without any problems. Maybe. Maybe. I replaced the casing, and when I turned the handle, I could feel some resistance. But the handle wouldn't turn. That was strange. What was wrong? Don't turn it more. Don't break something else. I looked back at the book. The parts were correct, and I put them in the right places. I tilted my head in confusion, and took the casing off again. And then I turned the handle with the casing still off. The gears were definitely aligned correctly. But perhaps because it hadn't been used in a while, the oil was all dried up. Maybe that's why the handle wouldn't turn. What to do? Should I go to Shiona and borrow some of her cooking oil? No, that wouldn't work. Cooking oil probably wasn't the same as the oil used in grease gears. It might work at first, but then cause problems later on. So, what should I do then? I then looked at my own right hand. It was covered with a glove, but there were exposed machine parts beneath that. Perhaps the oil used in my own hand would work. I took off my glove, looked closely at my right hand, at the machinery that was now clearly visible. There was oil inside it, to make it move smoothly. I stuck the screwdriver into my palm near the base of my thumb. Okay. I hope we're not just gonna break my, hand just to get this to work. When I removed the casing, I could see all the machinery used to move my hand, like wire cylinders and shafts. There was oil inside one of these cylinders. That's a lubrication in order to make sure you don't freaking break, but okay. It was easily removable to make it possible to replace the old oil. I used my left hand to take out the cylinder and dripped oil from inside it onto the music box gears. Well, I spread the oil around with my fingertip to get it on all the gears. Would this work? I put the cylinder back into my right hand and replaced the casing. After hiding my mechanical hand inside the glove again, I nervously turned the crank. At first it moved awkwardly, but as I turned the handle, the gears began to turn smoothly. At some point, the oil must have worked itself in between all of the gears, and the handle began turning without catching at all. And then that melody started to play. Shiona suddenly came into the room. Yeah. It's fixed, Shiona.
Arigato. Arigato, Rei. Arigato. Tottemo, tottemo ureshii.
Shiona smiled more brightly than I'd ever seen before. Just seeing her smile like that made a warmth build up inside my chest. And then I noticed. Oh, this must be it. This was what joy felt like. In that moment, I felt joy. I was overjoyed to see Shiona smile. And for the first time, I felt like I'd done something useful.
Arigatou, Rei. Arigatou.
Shiona took my hands and thanked me again and again. As her face drew close to mine, I could feel my own grow hot.
Rei no ganbari no okage de orgoru ga naotta nda yo. Watashi ga akiramete ita mata ano kyoku o kiku koto ga dekiru no. Onii-chan ga tsukutta orange iro no kono kyoku o watashi no daisuki na kono kyoku o.
Hey, Shiona, sing it for me. Let me hear your brother's song. I turned the handle of the music box, and the melody began to play. Shiona clapped her hands in front of her chest and started singing along with the melody. It was a song she'd been singing when we met. The song that she and his brother wrote. That orange-colored song. I felt like I finally understood it. The feeling inside of me. It was joy. Shiona's song. And Shiona's happiness as she sang it. Just watching her sing made me overflow with joy. Shiona sang more happily than ever before. And that day, Shiona kept singing until she fell asleep. And I listened closely, lost in that song. Shiona asked me again and again to play the song for her. She kept singing, until I could hardly keep moving my arm. As I watched her expression, I thought, I want to be together with Shiona forever. If Shiona wished for that too, I could be with her always. But for that to be possible, I could not let my true self be discovered. Absolutely not. Why? Maybe everyone's a fibroid that thinks everyone else is human. That day, I was more determined than ever to save Shiona forever. And it was night now, and the room had grown dark. As we lay side by side in our beds, Shiona spoke to me. Sure, what is it?
Happy.
I knew the word itself, but I didn't know exactly what it meant. Was it a state of being? Or was it just an emotion? I repeated the word happy to myself, again and again in my head.
それでね、手伝ってほしいの。
Oh, what do you want me to do?
明日ね、広場に一緒に行ってほしい。そして、オルゴールを回してほしい。
And you'll sing, right, Shiona?
ええ、そう。そして、一人でも多くの人に聞いてほしい。お兄ちゃんが作ったあのオレンジ色の曲を。
Yeah, I'd like that too. Of course I will help.
ありがとう、レイ。
I heard the sheets rustle. What is it, Shiona?
ねえ、レイ。手、つないでもいい？
It was too dark for me to see Shiona's expression. But I think she was blushing. You want to hold hands with me?
うん。レイとつなぎたい。ダメ？
I searched through all of my knowledge. I knew that sometimes people held hands. But I thought that had a special meaning for young men and women.
Day?
Sure, it's fine. If a human... If Shiona wanted something, I wanted to grant it to them. Fortunately, she was to my left. Since my hand covered with artificial skin was on that side, I did not think that it would be a problem. I reached out towards the bed next to mine. My hand felt cold in that chilly room. And I searched blindly for Shiona's hand. And when I touched it, it felt very warm. Shiona's hand clasped my own.
Atatakai ne.
I keep getting told that. And I keep thinking it myself when I touch people. Yeah, you're warm too, Shiona. We held hands. Our fingers entwined naturally. Without either of us really initiating it. I felt the warmth spread, and it wasn't just the body warmth from our hands. This was different from my artificial warmth. It was human warmth. Like this? I'm sorry, did that hurt? About this? We held hands all night long. Our hands were still clasped together when the morning light woke us. The next day, we filled the plaza with sound, and Shiona and I started performing. Shiona sang, and I played her brother's music box. At first, no one wandered by. Little by little, people gathered to hear Shiona's singing voice. First one, then two people stopped, and soon there was a small ring of them. Not long after the ring of people grew larger, the once deserted plaza bustled with activity. Everyone was entranced by Shiona's song. A couple leaned in close to each other and held hands. An old woman closed her eyes with deep emotion. A young man gazed at a young lady standing a little ways away. Parents and children laughed happily together. The children were moving their bodies along with the music. They were all listening to Shiona's song in their own way. But they had one thing in common. They were all smiling. Everyone listening to Shiona's song had smiles on their faces. I too felt warmth deep in my chest, knowing that I was helping to make all these people smile. I understood that this is what it is to feel happy. The emotion I felt yesterday when I saw Shiona smile, this is really it. Happiness. I was happy. I felt my cheeks lift a little. Must have been smiling. I probably looked a little awkward, but I didn't mind. If it brought me even a little closer to Shiona, that was enough for me. The newly fixed music box kept playing its melody without a hitch, and the handle spun easily. The sounds from the disc echoed and were amplified by the wooden box and spread throughout the air. Shiona called it an orange-colored melody, and along with that melody, Shiona sang, I wish that this time could continue on forever. And this time, spent making people smile. And I wanted to keep watching Shiona's happy face as she sang, forever. I happened to glance towards the library at the edge of town. I thought I saw the closed curtains move a little. And just for a moment, I saw a small figure. I knew who it was. That blue girl who was always crying. It was Tippy. She was probably crying now too. All alone in that library. And just thinking about it, I felt a small pain in my chest. It was like a thorn had pricked me. I wonder how Tippy felt as she watched this crowd of people. This constantly growing circle of smiles. Everyone here was smiling and sharing the same emotion. But I noticed just one person among them, with a scowl on his face. It was Man, with an angry expression and his arms crossed in front of him. He looked completely out of place, and was the only one with an angry expression on his face. As our eyes unexpectedly met, his were filled with emotion I still did not understand. It didn't even last a whole second. And after an instant, Matt snorted, turned on his heel, and disappeared into the crowd. As I watched him go, I thought, I wanted to make everyone smile. Even those who appeared sad or angry. I wanted to give smiles to being mad, but what could I do? I continued to think about it as I turned the music box's crank. And after that song was finished, I walked alone to Mad's shop. I couldn't get a scowl out of my mind. Sure. Okay, that's probably a good place to end this particular episode. I'm sort of recording this at whatever pace I feel like, so I may be ahead and whatnot. Like, the first episode hasn't even gone up yet, so... It's interesting, because this really plays very heavily on the emotional impact of everything. And it doesn't even play very close to the chest, because everything's about learning emotions, so... It's pretty interesting in terms of that. I'm still of the mind that I would be surprised if any of the people in the society were actually humans, basically. Well, it is what it is. So, I'll see you all next time. Drive safely, everyone.